आई एम डॉक्टर वेंकन्न कन्नबीना, आई एम वर्किंग एज ए असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन सेंट मार्टिन इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज सिकंदराबाद तेलंगाना. ओके, आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट पी-एन जंक्शन डायग्राम. PN junction diode. So before going to the topic, where these diodes are using, where these junctions are using. As we know, every electronic circuit like solar cells, transistors, LEDs, everywhere we are using these PN junctions. That is, what is this PN junction? Okay. Now we'll discuss when you combine P-type semiconductor and N-type semiconductor. It forms a junction, that is the PN junction. Okay, these are, we are using many devices, so many devices are working based on this PN junction. Okay, now we will discuss one by one. So semiconductors are three types. One is intrinsic and another is P-type, and second, third one is N-type semiconductor. We'll see how the P-type semiconductor forms, after that how the N-type semiconductor forms. We know fourth group elements, that is silicon. For this silicon atom, it has four valence electrons. When you add the third group elements like boron, aluminium, gallium, that is trivalent atoms, this is three valence electrons are there. Silicon having four valence electrons are there. When you combine these silicon, when you add boron atoms to this silicon atom, this forms a P-type semiconductor by sharing the one electron, they will share one. Silicon having four electrons, if you see this structure, this is silicon having here four valency electrons. And if you add boron or aluminium, third group atom, it has three valency electrons. By sharing these valency electron, they will share by covalent bond, and makes a, by sharing each electron, they make a covalent bond. And three silicon four electrons will share with three boron electrons. So one electron is deficiency to make a covalent bond. So that deficiency, here one deficiency, electron deficiency is there. This deficiency is filled by some other electron from the silicon atom. So breaking the covalent bond, and the silicon atom leaves the electron or gives the electron, and this will be filled. And like that, there is a holes forming in the silicon material. Okay, like that P-type semiconductor forms when you add third group element to silicon fourth group elements. So in P-type semiconductor, holes are the majority carrier. Similarly, when you see fifth group atoms, that means phosphorus, arsenic and antimony, if you add fifth group atoms to silicon atoms, fifth group is five valency electrons are there, and silicon having four valency electrons. By sharing four of each electron, they make four covalent bond, but phosphorus have an extra electron to share. So in this case, so electrons are the majority carrier. Some phosphorus having one extra electron to donate to the silicon atom. So in this way we are having extra electrons in N-type semiconductor. So this N-type semiconductor, electrons are the majority carrier, and P-type semiconductor, holes are the majority carriers. Okay. Now we will see how this junction is formed. So when you combine P and N-type semiconductor, this is P-type semiconductor and N-type semiconductor. When you combine these two semiconductors, it forms a junction or first interface. Okay, this is interface between P and N-type semiconductor. We know, just before we have discussed, in P-type, holes are the majority, and N-type, electrons are the majority. Okay, now, see, when you combine these two semiconductors, there is an interface, formation of interface, and because of charge carrier gradient in p-type semiconductor, holes will diffuse towards the n-type semiconductor. Holes will diffuse towards the n-type semiconductor. Okay. Here, this is the p-type and this is the n-type. Okay. Here holes, we know holes are the majority. Here holes will, here see, just write. I am writing down holes here. These are the electrons here. So here also some holes are there at near the interface. Here also some electrons. So these holes will diffuse into the n-type semiconductor. Okay, because of charge carrier gradient in the p-type semiconductor. Similarly, electrons in the n-type semiconductor will diffuse towards the n-type semiconductor. And while diffusing, they leave negative charge density in the negative n-type. And similarly, when holes diffuse from p-type to n-type semiconductor, they leave the negative ion density. And similarly, when electrons diffuse from n to p, they leave the positive charge ions here. These are immobile charge density. These are immobile charges. These charges mainly due to the donor density, and donor is phosphorus atoms and acceptor atoms are boron atoms here, or third group atoms or fifth group atoms respectively. Okay. This charge density due to the donor and acceptor density, these are immobile in a semiconductor junction or semiconductors. Okay. Because of this diffusion, we are calling this one. Okay. Once they leave, here we are getting an immobile charge density. This is we are calling depletion region. What is the depletion region? Depletion region. Okay. We are calling this one depletion region. Okay. In this depletion region, because of the charge density, there is a built-in potential. Built-in potential forms in the depletion region in this semiconductor junction. Okay. Once the depletion region is formed, there is a barrier to further cross the electrons. So whatever electrons in n-type semiconductor, they will see a potential barrier or some barrier height to cross into the p-type semiconductor. So they are unable to move into this semiconductor. Okay. That is the what we are calling potential barrier. Okay. And here the electric field direction also here positive to negative. That is here n to p. This is depletion region. Here electric field direction is positive to negative. That is internal. This electric field, what we are calling internal electric field. This is by leaving the electrons holes from one region to other region, this internal electric field is forming and also built-in potential. Okay. Up to this, suppose if you take small example here, we will see one small example. Suppose we have one beaker here. Here water level is up to here. This is some water level here. And we are taking one more beaker here. Here water level is up to here. So there is a difference in the water levels. So when you combine this one, when you combine these two beakers, the water level from higher beaker to this will flow into the lower beaker. Up to what time it will flow? So after certain time, the water level in two beakers is equal. So the time, that means here water level is same. So there is no flow from one beaker to other beaker even you connected. So for that, in that case, after that you have to add some external, you have to apply some external energy to send water from one beaker to other beaker. Here also same thing happens. Once the charge carrier gradient is equal in both sides, charge flow will be stopped. Okay. This is the simple p-n junction diode. Okay. This is, we are not applying any bias here. Without biasing, these charge carriers will move one semiconductor to other semiconductor. This junction we are calling p-n junction, and this is p-n junction diode. Okay. A p-n junction you can say. So what happens if you add forward bias condition and reverse bias condition? So why we need forward bias condition and reverse bias condition? Suppose without biasing, these electrons and holes see some potential barrier or potential height. So if these electrons want to go other side or holes want to go n-type semiconductor, they will see barrier height. So they don't have that much energy to overcome that barrier. So we have to give some external energy. That is what we are calling forward bias voltage or reverse bias voltage. Now we will see what happens if we apply forward bias condition.
Okay,
we will see here. Suppose, what is the forward bias condition means? Forward bias condition means positive terminal is giving to positive terminal of P side semiconductor is giving to positive potential of the battery, or this entire semiconductor is connecting to negative terminal of the battery or potential.
Okay,
that is the forward bias condition.
Okay,
we will draw it again. Here we will draw again this junction to clearly see this one. Okay, let's say again we are drawing the same diagram but in forward bias condition.
Okay,
we are applying forward bias. This is the interface and this is p-type semiconductor, we know, and this is n-type semiconductor. This is positive terminal and this is negative terminal. Negative terminal is connecting to negative n-type semiconductor and positive terminal is connecting to p-type semiconductor. So now what happens now at the interface? What happens? We are connected positive terminal to P and negative terminal to N. What happens here? The holes having positive charge. Okay, here we are connected positive potential and also electrons having negative charges. This is we know, and because of this negative potential, these electrons diffuse towards the interface, or these electrons repelled by this negative potential. Similarly, holes repelled by this positive potential. So here the depletion width is reducing or decreasing when you apply forward bias condition. We will see that one. Okay, this is the interface. So here the depletion width is decreasing. So this is again, there is a small depletion region here, negative ion density, and this is positive ion density. So this region we are calling neutral region. When you apply forward bias voltage, more holes are diffusing towards the interface and here ions or atoms are neutralizing. So neutral region is increasing when you apply forward bias condition, so that our depletion region width is decreasing. If depletion region width decrease, the electric field, that is internal electric field also reduces. Here internal electric field direction is not changing, only the magnitude is decreasing. Electric field is decreasing in forward bias condition.
Okay,
now see, also potential barrier height also reduces in forward bias condition. Now we will apply in reverse bias condition. We will see what happens in reverse bias condition. Okay, let's draw again the same diagram. Okay, otherwise I will draw it same figure. See, this is the we are connecting same diagram. We are connecting different potential or reverse bias condition. See, this is here, this is a battery, negative potential and positive potential. See here, negative potential is connecting to positive terminal of the semiconductor, or n-type semiconductor is connecting to positive terminal of the battery or potential. Okay, in this case what happening, these holes are holes in the p-type semiconductor attracting towards the potential, positive negative potential, and similarly electrons in n-type semiconductor attracting towards the positive potential of the battery. So that here the more electrons are leaving this region, neutral region, to and coming to the potential, so that our depletion width is increasing in reverse bias condition. Okay, that means here also more acceptor density or ion density is increasing in the depletion region. So in reverse bias condition, as we have seen in the figure, this one is the reverse bias. In the reverse bias condition, the depletion width is increased. This is the in case of forward bias condition. We know here we can see clearly, in forward bias the depletion width is decreased, so that electric field also decreases in the junction. And in reverse bias condition, the electrons attracted to the positive terminal and holes attracted to the negative terminal, so that our neutral region here increased. That means more electrons are leave from this place and also more holes, so that our neutral here depletion width is increased. if depletion width is increased means more charge density, that is immobile charge density will be formed here, so that here electric field also increased in the reverse bias condition. Okay, now we'll draw the band diagram to see clearly how it is, how the electrons seeing potential barrier and how the band bending happening in a semiconductor, we will see here. Okay, first we will draw for without biasing condition, we will draw the band diagram. Okay, let's see here. Suppose how, before that it is very easy to draw band diagram, just we follow the some simple technique. Okay, first you draw the interface. When you combine p-type and n-type semiconductor, there is an interface, formation of interface. Just you draw the interface, and we know at equilibrium condition, at thermal equilibrium condition, the Fermi level is constant throughout the semiconductor. Just before we have seen one example, water beaker example, there also the at equilibrium condition the Fermi level is constant throughout the semiconductor. What this Fermi level means? Fermi level indicates the charge carrier density in a semiconductor. Suppose if n-type semiconductor, the Fermi level is close to the conduction band, and p-type semiconductor, this Fermi level close to the valence band. Okay, first we will draw this Fermi level, this EF, this is EF. So this is, here we are taking p-type semiconductor, here n-type semiconductor. Okay, so for n-type semiconductor, Fermi level close to the conduction band, let's draw this one. Okay, and valence band away from the conduction band. Okay, and next one, for p-type semiconductor, this Fermi level is close to the valence band and conduction band is away from the valence band. Okay, now we have drawn energy levels from p-type and n-type semiconductor. Now next job is to join these levels. Conduction band is conduction band and valence band is valence band. Okay, just draw equally. Okay, like this. Okay, now it is very easy to draw band diagram here. Okay, this is the, what is this one? Is the depletion region. Okay, what we have observed, this depletion region is same as here also. Okay, so why these are band bending is forming? So electrons in the conduction band of n-type semiconductor and holes in the valence band, here these electrons, these holes are free, they can move freely. And here electrons, once you combine the p and n semiconductor, electrons diffuse from one type n-type to p-type, then there is a upward band bending, this upward band bending. So here p-type is receiving the electrons. Okay, or here p-type is receiving the electrons, or here if you see here valence band, these holes are, it holes are leaving this p-type semiconductor. So here downward band bending. If it is upward here, there is upward, or downward here, same patterns it follow. Okay, suppose as you see here, suppose here upward band bending is there, here also upward band bending. So this is the simple diagram band bending. Okay, see now where is the potential barrier. Okay, when you see this one, here is the, we can see this one, this is the potential barrier, this one we are calling built-in potential or potential barrier. Okay, now see, in thermal equilibrium condition, these electrons are seeing this much height or this much barrier to cross or to flow into the p-type semiconductor. So to overcome this barrier or this height, we have to give some external voltage. That is what we are giving forward bias and reverse bias condition. Okay, now we will draw the forward bias condition. Okay, it is same as, like you draw like this, same. And I am drawing again, just like this. And here also I am drawing like this. Okay, in forward bias condition, the Fermi level is not constant. So there is a small difference in the Fermi level. So this is the Fermi level. The built-in potential width will decrease in forward bias condition, VBI minus VF. Okay, and this is the bit, or you can write here also VBI minus VF. Okay, in C, this is the forward bias condition. When you give positive turn forward bias condition, positive potential to p-type and negative potential to n-type. Now we will see here the back, this width also, this will also decrease, the depletion width also decrease. Now we will draw same in reverse bias condition, what happens. Okay, so the depletion width increase and the potential barrier height also increases. Like this.
Okay.
Like this. This is P type again. This is N type. Here you can see this barrier height also increase. This is the VBI plus VR. So potential height is increased for here also. This is the Fermi level for P type and this is the Fermi level for N type. Okay. You can see here clearly the barrier height is increased for reverse bias condition and the depletion width also increases. So in reverse bias condition, you have the electrons or holes need more energy to cross the barrier. In forward bias condition, less voltage required to cross the barrier. Depending on our requirement, we are applying forward bias or reverse bias condition. So depending on our device, suppose if you take LED light emitting diode, we are connecting in a forward bias condition. Okay, if you take solar cell, we are connecting in a reverse bias condition. Depending on our application, we are connecting either forward bias condition or reverse bias condition. This is the about PN junction diode in without biasing condition and forward bias and reverse bias condition. Tomorrow in the next session we will discuss IV characteristics of PN junction diode and IV equations and some applications where we are using. We will see. Okay, thank you.